Espargaró in pole position. He's been on the podium for the last five races. He's had a three wins. It's a big ask for him, 48 points behind Marc Márquez in the championship. His fifth pole of the season, of course, the winner in Aragon. All he can do is try and keep the pressure on Marc Márquez. As we've seen in Moto3, things can happen. But just one podium finish here in Motegi. A couple of years ago, third in the 125cc race. Those his great hope is that he has his teammate Tito Rabat also on the front row of the grid, and he may just be able to get in amongst him and Marc Márquez. Marc Márquez, it's not the easiest weekend to crash with Mika Kallio. A fair bit of controversy in third practice session on a Saturday morning. He is the world championship leader, his 11th front row start of the season. 125cc winner here a couple of years ago. Second in the Moto2 race last year. He is utterly focused on winning that world title. I have a feeling nothing, absolutely nothing, is going to stop him doing that. Here is Tito Rabat. First time ever on the front row in a Moto2 race, 8th in the World Championship. He's had 3 fourth places. Now the time to step up and help his teammate.
Well, we're just talking about Tito Rabat on the grid. I'm down here with the Pons team owner, Tito Pons. Tito, Pol Espargaró starting again on pole today. Still chasing the championship leader, Marc Márquez. But a big advantage here in Motegi is that Tito Rabat is on the pace and also on the front row. What are you expecting of Tito today?
I think he's going to do a good race. He's capable to do it. He do all the times alone. I think he's ready to make his own pace, and I think we expect to have a good race for both of them.
I mean, a team order is going to be in play during this race?
Well, we don't know for the moment. I mean, they must do this race and then we will decide.
Okay, thanks, Ito. Good luck for something.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, two of his rows on the front. We had a look at the second row. Scott Redding, as we were saying earlier, in good form, four podiums this season. Then Tom Lutie, was third here last year, fourth in the World Championship, one win. And Johan Zarco, he could be right up there this weekend, ninth in the World Championship, but his one and only Grand Prix victory came here last year in the 125s.
I'm just going to grab a quick word with Scott Redding. Scott, second row on the grid, but you've been on the pace here all weekend. Only missed out with a near crash in qualifying, which I believe left some of your nether regions a little bit sore. But all set for this race. Could you see yourself fighting at the front for another podium here this weekend?
Yeah, it's definitely tough out there. You know, everyone's so close together. And, you know, the long stretch is going to be hard until the break. I think we can go with these guys.
And I guess because you're not talking soprano, everything okay after the near high side yesterday?
Yeah.
All right, good luck this afternoon, Scott.
Yeah, it's been a good ride for him and Bradley Smith. It starts behind. Bradley Smith has been in good form, had a big crash on Friday morning. Second in practice on Friday afternoon. Second in the morning, just had some vibration problems in qualifying. Makes a good start. It's going to be interesting with him and Scott Redding. Former 125cc world champion Julian Simon is qualified on that third row of the grid. Up and down season for Julian Simon, 14th in the world championship. Was runner up in that first ever Moto2 world championship a couple of years ago. Interestingly enough, joining him on that third row of the grid, the very last 125cc world champion, Nico Tirol. He's only 18th in the world championship, Tirol, but I tell you, he has had. Just starting to really settle in, I think, to that Moto2 ride, and he has been rewarded with a ride or a contract with the Aspar team for the next couple of years. A look at Axel Pons a little bit further ago, but now we come with Nico Tirol, as I say. Takes time to settle. He did in the 125cc class, but of course, when it mattered, he went on to win that world title last year. And obviously, the Aspar team have great faith in him. But it'll be good to see him getting nearer the podium in the last four Moto2 races of the season. And the return of the former world champion Tony Elias. So the Moto Trans team replacing Claudio Corti. disappointing for Cordy, who was running a 10th at the championship, but obviously Tony Elliott is a former world champion and a former MotoGP winner, able to bring some sponsorship along, and it's a tough time at the end of the season. These three flyaway races, Tony Elliott of course replaced Hector Barber also in the MotoGP team, he was injured back in the MotoGP. Maki Nakagami, the local boy, 15th in the world championship, was qualified on the fourth row of the grid, 11th fastest, led the way in the first practice session on a Friday, had a tumble, but a good starter as well, urged on by the crowd. I imagine certainly in the early stages he could be well up there with the leaders. Completing that fourth row of the grid, we're going to have a look at Simone Corsi. Maybe only be 12th in the World Championship. Had a real up and down season because he did take pole position in Aragon a couple of weeks ago. 5 minutes before the start of the race, 23 laps. It's round 14 of the Moto2 World Championship. It's nice to see umbrellas up to shade from the sun. Here is a Simone Corsi, who's former 125cc Grand Prix winner. Rode brilliantly in the qualifying in Aragon. Good start from Corsi, can mean he can be right up there as well. That's your first four lines of the grid for this crucial Moto2 battle, round 14 of the championship. Just remind you, Marquez leads the way by 48 points. From the pole setter, Paul Espargaro. Takahashi, well, not had a particularly good season, as he put it. It's an important race for him. Often it's his home race. And former 250cc and Moto2 Grand Prix winner. Important race for this front row. Can Tito Rabat do anything to help his teammate Paul Espargaro, who trails Marc Marquez by 48 points? But as always, a bit of controversy surrounding Marc Marquez. There is Tito Rabat, his first ever Moto2 front row start. Marc Marquez, his 11th front row start of the season, 48 point lead in the World Championship. Paul Espargaro in pole position, 3 wins this season. He won the last round in Aragon. All he can do is go out there once again, win the race from Marc Marquez, and hope that others, including teammate Rabat, help him. So welcome back to Motegi. It's round 14 of the Moto2 World Championship. I'm Nick Harris, sitting alongside me, Gavin Emmett, down in pit lane, Ian Wheeler. This promises to be another big race, doesn't it?
Three Spaniards lining up on that front row of the grid, all about with capabilities of finishing on the podium. And of course, winning it as well, Scott Redding heads up row two alongside Tom Lucy and Joe Antarco. And Bradley Smith heading up row three. Probably belies a little bit his pace. He should be maybe a bit higher up the grid considering how well he's gone this weekend. They can see Tony Elias, he's back in action and look good this weekend on occasion. Fourth row of the grid in 10th, replacement for Claudio Corti this weekend. Again, same for Am West, actually, should be perhaps higher up the grid than 20th position. Suggests he was 10th fastest after free practice. Don't rule out the chance of points for Am West. We saw Ratapat Willerot heading up row 9. Gino Rios had lots of problems this weekend with the bike. Well, that's nothing new to him this season, is it? He heads up row 10 in 28th place. It's Paul Espargaro who will start from pole position. And alongside him, Marc Marquez. You know it's going to be fierce out there. It could be, it's going to be something as exciting as in Moto3.
You know, I think it could be, and I think it could be as exciting as Moto2 in Aragon, because the riders behind them, okay, so Espargaro and Marquez, and that's the championship, but the likes of Scott Redding, Johan Zarco, Tito Rabat, Bradley Smith, who's looked in such good form. They make good starts, they're going to be right in there, aren't they? And we've got dear old Andrea Iannone back in 18th place, who's had crashed in the morning warm-up, crashed in qualifying, had a right old bad time, but as we know, sixth row start for Andrea Iannone doesn't mean he won't be up there.
He had a fairly decent time in warm-up this morning. He seems to be pushing things on before his crash. fairly innocuous crash for him, but it's been a couple this weekend, bike problems as well. It's not been an easy going for the Italian.
Perfect conditions once again, Ian. Talk about fluffy white clouds, and it's just fluffy white clouds still, isn't it?
But it's actually a good thing to run through to them, because they've been doing their pre-practice qualifying sessions at the last session each afternoon when the sun started to go down and the conditions are cool. And actually this cloud cover now over the surface means the conditions are pretty close to what we had yesterday for qualifying and Friday afternoon for pre-practice. So for them, ideal.
So we're saying the championship can't be decided in this race. 48-point advantage for Marc Márquez.
Yeah, but as we saw in Moto 3, things can happen. Things can happen. Not anymore, but...
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm talking about arrogant Moto 2 and Moto 3 race here. I don't know whether Nick's pacemaker will stand up to another race like that.
I'm a bit worried about the pacemaker, a bit worried about my voice as much as anything else. But yeah, we have been so lucky the last few weeks. We have seen some absolutely unbelievable motorcycle
racing. It does just seem to get better and better.
Yeah, it does. You wonder if they can, and then we get the last lap for that sake, and then in the way, the Moto3. If you want to see one of the most dramatic last laps I've ever seen in a Grand Prix race, you want to watch that. It is amazing. And I believe the controversy is still going on afterwards about it. Certain people not happy about what happened. So that is going to rumble on. Some of these are not long to rumble on before the next race, doesn't it? This makes it even more interesting. There you go, confirmation of those championship positions. 48 points, Márquez and Espargaró. That's one of those two is going to win the world title. All fingers point at Marc Márquez, but never, never.
Been a few fingers pointed in other ways this weekend. But he'll put that completely behind him. Gets on, and he's likely to have a very good shot at winning this race. Little wave from Pol Espargaró, who's obviously very calm, isn't he?
God, you wave like that just before the start, absolutely crucial race. Well, yeah, why not?
Watching yourself on the big screen as you come down the straight and line up in pole alongside your championship rival.
If you want to unsettle him, Barry Sheen always used a lot of cigarette on the grid, didn't he? Drilled a hole in his helmet, and they just used to really unsettle people. So here we go. Round 14 of the Moto2 World Championship. The red flag has been taken away. Can we please have a repeat of Aragon 2 weeks ago here at round 14?
Oh, Márquez has stalled on the grid. I do not believe it. More drama at the start of Márquez. He's going to be right towards the back of the field as Espargaró leads through turn one. I do not believe it. He's going to make up position. There's no doubt about it. Remember the race in Australia last year? Almost Jordi Torres goes down. And you see Márquez already fighting his way through, weaving past. He's in up in front of Andrea Iannone.
Scott Redding leads the way from the Two Ponds bite. Márquez has got to be careful, though. We've seen making your way back through the field can cause massive, massive problems. Wow, the last lap of Moto 3. We start Moto 2. And it's kicking off again.
Well, he comes very close to the inside there of Dominika Goethe, down into turn five. One ball with Marc Márquez, trying to follow the inside line through with Johan Zarco. He's got through about six riders in that corner, and already Márquez is making his way through quickly. He dropped all the way almost to the back of the field, and as they come through now, he's up into 10th place.
He has done an amazing
that's a
job.
Bad start, and he's just completely as if it didn't happen.
Oh, forget that. That's it.
Scott, amazing.
Scott Redding leads away.
Remember him starting from the back of the grid in Australia last year because the penalty, having taken out Radbot Willerott during the warm-up. Well, he came back and finished third in that race. I think he's got every chance of winning this one now. So he's right back in it. It's not been a penalty to him too much at all. He's recovered brilliantly. Mark of a champion.
There he is, Marc Márquez. Dreadful start. Scott Redding, great start from the second row of the grid. He leads away from Pol Espargaró and Tito Rabat. Bradley Smith just hangs on there in a fourth place in front of Tom Lutie.
Antoni Elias goes through on Lutie, up into sixth place. What a start to his career with the Ital Trans team. On board the Calix bike that he was demanding from Aspar. That's why they went their separate ways. He had a spell in MotoGP as a replacement for Hector Barber. He's back in Moto2 now. Instead of Claudio Corti, which is very tough on the Italian, who's 10th in the World Championship. And both Redding and Espargaró ran it wide in turn one there. Espargaró, in fact, followed Redding in. and Redding still hangs on, but Rabat takes second from his teammate.
Absolutely, when he followed Scott Redding in.
Where's Bradley Smith gone? He's dropped right back there. He's had a moment in turn one.
Down in 10th, is he?
4th to 10th. There's a start here from Marquez. Well, just not gone. But he's...
He didn't put it in gear.
It was in neutral.
Oh, Emilio Azamora just cannot believe it.
Schoolboy error from Marquez.
That is unbelievable. He's forgot to put it in gear.
Perhaps it was that way from Paul Espargaro that unsettled him.
We are so lucky as well that no one collected him.
Dead right. Right. Better focus on what's happening at the front. The Mark Marquez will probably have just to say about that.
Marquez is just behind Mika Kallio on track.
Oh dear, after a big incident in free practice on a Saturday morning. Scott Redding leads away, and it's Tito Rabat putting some big pressure now on Scott Redding.
I tell you what, that's an impressive start from Mika Kallio in 7th at the moment, from 15th on the grid. But it, like you say, it'd be interesting to see what happens when he sees who's behind him.
Massive moment from Espargaro there, down into the hairpin. And that's only music to Marc Marquez's ears.
Wow. He certainly seems to be having some trouble, Paul Espargaro. Turn one, now at the hairpin. Here comes Tito Rabat up the inside of Scott Redding. Rabat leads away. Tony Elias.
You're not
going to return for the former world champion in third place.
Rarely going to get past him on the brakes when he's in the middle of a scrap. He puts the bike sideways into the corner, blocks all the corner for you, and he's extremely late. Redding having a little bit of a twitch through victory corner as well. And now it's Tito Rabat takes over at the front across the line. Long way to go. You see Marquez, number 93. He's going to attack Mika Kallio now down into turn one. Kallio's going to hold the bike on the inside. And is he going to try and come back through? No, but he's done well there to actually just stick with Marquez.
Is he going to have another little go, Mika Kallio? No. I think Marquez has got through quite safely this time round. But Paul Espargaro, a couple of moments, is it nerve for him? Turn one, man at the hairpin for the man who's second in the World Championship. And really, he wants to be where Tito Rabat is and try and keep some men between him and Marc Marquez.
Yeah, he really needs to, he has to win the race to keep the championship alive, really. Especially now with Marquez right up in sixth place.
Yeah, interesting, Paul Espargaro. Scott Redding doing an excellent job. Already a fourth podium this season.
Yeah, he had a bit of a moment there. He's lost touch slightly on Tito Rabat. The gap has gone out to 0.8, but just wonder how much of this is going to be in tyre conservation, that kind of thing. As Zarco comes through fiercely on Kallio. That's where Kallio and Marquez had the incident. The first part of it was there, and then on the inside here at the hairpin during free practice.
Lifted away from the car when he comes through as well, didn't he? What a rough old ride, didn't he, Mika Kallio, at the early stage of the race? 3 times winner here at Motegi.
Having made such a good start as well.
I've got to say, Rabat is doing a really good job out front, and that's all he can do. He really can't worry about Paul Espargaro at the moment, can he?
Gani comes through on Zarco. This is good for the home fans, up into 7th place. Good day actually for Italian transfer. Elias in 3rd, and Gani now in 7th. Elias shouldn't, in theory, be there by the end of the race. He will likely drop back, but how the others get past him as the race develops. Luthi doesn't want to do Marquez any favours. They've had their moments on a couple of occasions this year.
Certainly have, as he rode with Marc Marquez, wasn't it? Last lap, first bend of the last lap in Qatar. And Luthi perhaps could have gone on to win the race. Here comes Marquez on the brakes. No, decides to just wait this time. He's done a lot of the hard work now, Marquez. He just wants to be a little bit careful now, doesn't he? He's got the leaders inside. You've got to say, a remarkable recovery after a schoolboy error on the line.
Here comes Espargaro. He's going to get through on the inside of Tony Elias. And very hard for Elias to come back from that one, and he hasn't. So Marquez up to 5th through on Luthi. That must have been on the exit of turn 4, and Espargaro up into 3rd place.
I was going to say, Marquez, a bit of a problem off the start there, but you still don't write him off for this move, except for the fact that Marquez is a rider who likes to build the heat in the tyres at the start of the race, not go too hard. Unfortunately, here in Motegi, he hasn't had the choice. He's had to go hard from the start to make the first places. And it may come back to haunt him later on in the race. And he just may ride around the problem and take the win anyway.
Never rule anything out with him. You certainly wouldn't have thought he'd have tried to start the race in neutral, would you? Absolutely staggering mistake by Mark Marquez.
To be fair to Mark Marquez, he could have just checked the clutch bite on the line.
Or it could have been
a false. And it was enough to just kick the bike out. Yeah.
Bradley Smith is there behind Joan Zarco, who's in ninth, behind Callio in eighth, then it's Nakagami still in seventh. A gap of about three quarters of a second up to Luthi, who's behind Marquez now, and then it's Elias is about three quarters of a second ahead of Marquez, with Espargaro third, Redding second, and Rabat now a second clear of Redding. Redding struggling a little bit down into that turn one, run it wide on a couple of occasions now. Suddenly to get that bike stopped.
Just a quick update from pit lane. Looks like Bradley Smith is out of this race with a mechanical issue.
Yeah, he had been quick in all practice sessions. Qualified seventh was a bit probably not where he would have liked to be. A couple of problems at the end of the session with a few vibrations of the bike. And had to retire, so clearly a problem.
Right with Pol Espargaró. Has he got up the inside of Scott Redding? He certainly has. Now he's moved up into second place as his teammates are here back in front of him. This is more where he'll like to be. He'll want to get out the front and hope that the likes of Tito Rabat, Scott Redding, and anybody else, Tony Elias as well, can keep Mark Marquez away from the podium finish or even towards the front of the race just to close that advantage in the World Championship. It's interesting what Ian said as well about Marquez having to ride so hard in those early laps. Doesn't like to do.
I think Redding, to me as well, looks very comfortable at this early stage, the way he's riding. Just that turn one on a couple of occasions now, he's pushed it a little bit deep, but around that flowing section, looked very nice in the corners, looked comfortable. Again, it's just in these much harder braking areas, there at the hairpin as well, struggling to get the bike stopped and turned. Tony Elias is the big surprise for me. Whether he'll be able to last the pace, I really doubt it.
Bradley Smith out of the race. Big crash for him on Friday morning.
And here comes Elias on the inside now of Scott Redding.
Reinvented Tony Elias, isn't it? Terrific stuff.
Rode the bike last week.
Somewhere in Spain, wasn't it?
Yeah, it wasn't that bike actually, it was someone else's in the Spanish championship at the last circuit. And he got a feel of the bike. Matt Marquez had just set the fastest lap of the race.
Yeah, we ride with him. That's Scott Redding in front of him. Tony Elias has got to pick himself.
Again, Redding wide at turn one, and Marquez is just going to go straight through. Struggling in the right-hand turns when he's having to get the bike stopped. And just wondering that issue might be there for Redding.
Well, Mark Marquez, 125, he's a world champion a couple of years ago, closing right up on Tony Elias, the Moto2 world champion a couple of years ago. Inside into turn five, Marquez is through. It's as if nothing happened to him at the start, isn't it? It's just ridden through the problem straight away. You do have to admire him, don't you?
Oh, yeah,
you do.
Completely.
There's no grey areas in Mark Marquez. It's why they really like him. You can really, really upset me, but he is once ever a motorcycle racer.
Yeah, you see again, just not able to get that bike stopped, Redding. Moments for the team as they watch on. Elias is riding very defensively as well now to keep Redding at bay. This is could be where we see Elias drop back. I just wonder if Redding has what it takes to be able to get past him. You'd have thought so from his practice pace.
Down the back straight towards the 90 degree corner.
Interestingly, Espargaro now has the gap under a second to his teammate Rabat. It was at 1.2.
And look at Callio. It's Tito Rabat. Done a sterling job for the team up front. He's got an even more important job to do, though, to help try and help Pol Espargaró. Pol Espargaró gets to the front and really make life difficult for Mark Marquez. But I've got to say, the form Mark Marquez is in. It's going to take somebody brave to stop him here.
He's just done a 151.4, which would have put him in fifth place on the grid. That's a very, very good lap for Marquez. Again, how much is he having to use? He doesn't need to win the race. That much is really clear. He can still get to Malaysia and have a very decent advantage.
I don't know if that's in his locker deal, but not Mark Marquez's style at all. Aubrey Ryder with Paul Espargaro. Marcus Marquez right behind him. So he closes the advantage on Tito Rabat at the front, which he's doing. Marquez is quite happy to sit in there and wait and bide his time. There's still a long, long way to go.
I would have thought you think that Mark Marquez would try and win this race.
Oh, no, not at all.
I mean, you know, Marquez never, ever shuts up.
I'm just saying, though, he doesn't need to.
No, he doesn't need to. He probably doesn't know or care.
Yeah.
You know, but
moment for Espargaro. A big moment. The foot peg went down and he saved it. He saved it. But Marquez has taken advantage. And through he goes. They all are having problems out there. Redding has got through on Elias briefly, but Elias will probably have the straight line speed.
Very interesting, isn't it?
Redding and Elias almost coming together, and down is, we've talked about Elias in his late break, he's going to run extremely wide there, and Redding can get through finally. And I think now he's probably shot of Elias.
So why are they having so many problems here? Obviously, something different than what they've seen in qualifying.
Just put me on the spot there, Nick.
Look at that again. Yeah. He's had a couple of those already in these early stages. He does ever so well to hang on to the back.
Could have collected them both at one point, couldn't he?
Maybe what we're seeing is a change in the track conditions. You know, they talk about the temperature being a little bit lower than it has been the last 2 days. And yeah, we just could see some people taking a chance on tyres, maybe, and getting some reaction from the changing track conditions.
Tito Rabat, soldiers on at the front, but you've got that inevitable feeling that Marc Marquez will be with him in the not-too-distant future.
Clearly, Espargaro was having to push on the lap previously to start closing in on Rabat. So Rabat's pace is extremely consistent at the front. How long is it going to last towards the end of the race? We have seen him fade, and one thing he pointed out yesterday in the interviews after qualifying was, in the past I've faded, I don't think I will here, the way we've worked this weekend. We'll just have to wait and see that. We're nowhere near the halfway point of this race.
Back leads away from Marquez. Dramatic start. It was clear that Marc Marquez had the bike in neutral. Made a dreadful start, but fought his way back through for the first couple of laps. Bradley Smith out of the road. It's a mechanical problem. Marquez now up in the second place. Moments for Paul Espargaro and Scott Redding.
Yeah, Antonio Elias now in fifth. Wheaties closing in on him. Further down the order, just to take a look back. Tarquin in 10th, and I'm expecting him to be a lot higher, actually. His pace suggested he might be right up there this weekend. Axel Pons is going down in 13th. And West is leading Nico Troll in the battle for 14th place. So, as we suggested, Westy very close to the point. And here, Marc Marquez is going to be very close to the win. If not going to take it as he challenges Rabat down in towards turn one.
Yeah, Rabat will know he's there now. Will Marquez bide his time? I doubt it. I think he'll get past Rabat and just get their head down. Down towards turn three they go.
Espargaro's just set his personal best lap, as has Scott Redding as well, interesting. Remember the race at Aragon, where we saw Espargaro looking like he had problems during the race, but then was able to pull a gap at the front. Helped out by Andrea Iannone, of course. Iannone, by the way, is down in 18th place and he's not going to do anything in this race.
Marquez thought about going through on Tito Rabat at turn 5. That's where he got past Tony Elias.
It's sketchy there.
Yeah, they do. You're right. It could be the change in temperature. We ride with Marc Marquez, championship leader. The Polish driver is still running fourth place. The longer Tito Rabat can hold him up, the better it will be for Polish driver.
It is really closing up between the front three now. Big look behind from Espargaro. See, Redding is 1.5 seconds behind him.
He wanted to go through that, didn't he, Marquez? And Rabat just made sure there's nowhere for him to go. He may have another go down the 90-degree corner. Beautifully placed, didn't he?
I think he'd have the drive and the pace to get past Rabat. But Rabat's strong on the brakes. A big lad is Tito Rabat. And then he's going to run it a bit wide on exit. Should come back in front of Marquez. Marquez is happy to. He doesn't want to make a silly pass. And he's just letting Rabat ride as he wants. And he'll pick his moment here. Rabat looks a little bit looser than he does. And he'll go through at some point soon. If he turns 5.
sixth. Now towards the S-curves, slightly uphill, left and right. He called on a hairpin. I fancy we'll have a get close enough, it will be down at that 90 degree corner at the end of the back straight. I think he quite fancies the hairpin as well. He had a little nibble up there last time. Coming up to it now.
Again, he knew he had to shorten it a little bit wide because he knew that he had come up to the back and he'd gone through the line he was taking. Not like Espargaro's closing on these two at the moment. Here he comes once more, down in towards the 90 degree corner. And now he will just take the back's line and take over out the front. Could well be one-way traffic all the way from here now.
Yeah, I think it's now firmly in the hands of Tito, Paul Espargaro. Because I think Marquez will get the hammer down now. And no disrespect to Tito Rabat, I think Espargaro's got to get past him and see if he can close up on Marquez. That's been an extraordinary ride by Marquez after that start.
Well, he went it deep into turn one this time, but more than anything, he's going to be squirting at that time.
13 laps to go.
Still, Elias is tagging onto the back of Redding as he's looting.
I was going to say, I think he might be a bit rash here, writing off Tito in the back.
Yeah.
So soon, he's got some motivation to get back into the Mark Marquez, and I think he's going to put the out to do it as well.
I don't think he's going to be able to personally. I can't just keep going.
Maybe he won't be able to, but I guarantee
he can take it.
Could only quite spectacular fashion for Tito in the back.
A black flag out there for a wildcard rider, Nozane, the Japanese rider, and so he will be called in.
Well, he's already been in once after the crash, he's only just rejoined the race, so he'll be straight back into pit lane.
Well, not quite the race we saw in Aragon, but an amazing performance by Marc Márquez after not able to start, quite as neutral, and as Gavin said, he was a very, very lucky boy not to get hit from behind. Giving up the fight in any way at all. And if he could rough him up in some way, it just may help on this battle. There is the black flag.
Well, Coach Nozane will be forced to come in. The second coming on his bike as well. I think maybe because he'd got into the pits. Actually got into his pit box.
Marquez leads the way up into the victory corner. Back hanging in there. Paul Espargaro still in third place. He doesn't want that gap to open up at the front. You're right at Aragon. He didn't look too comfortable in the early stages, didn't he, Paul Espargaro? Very, very strong towards the end. Who knows?
Tony Lewis has done very well in this race. I thought his pace was going to drop significantly. Well, it has, but so has Reddick's. And it's Tom Lutie who's actually quicker than those two riders. But he's having to push extremely hard to stick with Marquez, who in turn is pushing very, very hard indeed. Elias is slipping and sliding all over the track. What became very familiar in 2010 when he won this championship.
I'll tell you what, Tito Rabat couldn't be doing a better job. Okay, he's not quite what we're close enough to put in the path, but he's forcing Marquez to carry speed, to carry pace, to carry on using those tyres that we know he's had to use to get up to the front after the start problem.
Yeah, he's doing a brilliant job. You can, Valentino Rossi used to do this, didn't he? You pressure people from behind, don't you? You've got all to make the save.
Tony Elias is trying everything he knows in that long, long book he's got, those overtaking manoeuvres in different fashions to get through on Redding, but Redding was wise to that one, allowed him to push it in, went wide, and Redding came back on the inside. That one had run along.
Oh, that's a big slide there, I mean. Wonder how much tyre wear he has used to get where he is. Still 11 and a half laps to go. They're on that back straight. They're coming up against back markers already. Perhaps Paul Espargaro is comfortable there and just having to let this pan out in front of him.
It's not like he's not slipping his slider home as well.
Redding.
Oh,
there he is. Yeah.
Mechanical problems. He run off track. Back in the saddle because he's just pulled it in front of Alex De Angelis. He's had a tough weekend. Off in the gravel at the hairpin.
it's going to be.
Yeah. He just pushed very hard up through to turn one to try and close on Marquez. I think now Espargaro's going to go, right, you know what, you haven't been able to do it. I'm going to come through on you here.
Spot on. Done a good job, but Marquez is now getting away at the front. It's down to me now. It's going to be a very, very important couple of laps.
2/10 across the line, 1.1 when they went through under the tunnel.
Obviously, the state buying up with that, but also it's because Marquez is really getting the hammer down, isn't he? What can Paul Espargaro do? 48-point lead in the championship by Marc Marquez. And Espargaro has finished on the podium in the last five races. He won the last one in Aragon.
He's underlined the credentials of why he should be champion this year and why he's been picked by Repsol Honda to replace the talent that is Casey Stoner.
Paul Espargaro in second place, Tito Rabat has done a sterling job now. I think Tito Rabat should be getting a podium finish here.
Hang on to the back of his teammate as long as he can. But remember, he was pushing hard in those early laps. How much tyre has he used? We have seen in the past him fade in the races, and although however much he says he's worked this weekend, how hard he had to push in those early laps will affect the end of his race.
Tom Lutti. Further down. Finishing that Ducati behind him. Swimming smaller in the ninth place. Tom Lutti in the tenth. This is a really good scrap of fourth place.
To start 10th, but his practice by the end of three practices around the 15-16 mark. So to be up there in fifth place, battling Reading for fourth, is impressive.
Paul Espargaro is not letting Marquez get away, is he? He's just clawed back a very, very small amount. Alesi's brother looks on, of course, he's got the MotoGP race to come.
I've seen him get stronger as races go on, and also look a little bit not comfortable, look a little uncomfortable in those first laps of a race, or first half of a race, and despite that, still manages somehow to pull it out of the bag at the end.
Yeah, three wins this season for Paul Espargaro. Of course, a lot of controversy, that incident in Barcelona with Marc Marquez.
Meanwhile, by the way, just down the back, Ant West is up into 12th place after Callio dropping back in Zarco, of course. He seems to have had a problem.
Gino Rea currently running in 22nd place behind Alex Cameron.
Espargaro has just set the new fastest lap of the race, the new circuit record in the race, with a 151.3.
I think as far as the race goes, that's exactly what we wanted to hear, wasn't it?
Just under 9 laps left in this Grand Prix. That sparks fly again in that corner from Espargaro. That's where he almost went down a few laps ago. Nico Tirol clearly having his problems. He was in 14th place. Westerby pulling away from him. And he's running wide and he's going to drop like a stone down the order. Joins behind DeAndres in 21st. Turn one. It's caught so many people out this weekend. And watch out in MotoGP, because I've never seen so many people run off track as they did during warm-up this morning. And with the temperature change, I mean, it is now, just looking out the window, Ian, the clouds have fully covered it over the track.
It's gone very, very cloudy, especially down towards the last turn. Dark clouds as well. The temperature has definitely dropped. The wind has picked up. The rain we were talking about earlier isn't going to come in this session, but it's not far away.
This race is far from over. Marquez, maybe 8 laps ago when they crossed the line, they're down at the 90 degree corner. Espargaro just eking back metre by metre. Advantage of the championship leader. Started the race in neutral, made an appalling start and just battled. making his way through the field on those first three or four laps. This championship's all about these two, really, isn't it?
It's
going to come at it again.
You know, he's had his days. Lutie's had his days as well. Scott Rennie on occasion has been up there, but it's been about the two Spaniards. A bit like, really, in MotoGP, minus Casey Stoner. Espargaro's got even quicker on that last lap, 151.275.
7.5 laps to go. It's round 14 of that Moto2 World Championship. The two championship leaders in the right position as far as the championship goes, and the race, because it's finally that leads the way from Espargaro.
Slow motion shot of Marquez. That bike picked up, lets that rear tyre slip out and help him steer around the corner onto the back straight.
Scott Rennie's doing a good job. Tell you what, Tony Elias is, I think he's enjoying his return, don't you? Very much like the old Tony Elias, isn't he? And Tom Lutie right in there with him. That'll be a good race right to the finish for fourth place. It's going to be a good race right to the finish. Tito Rabat. Going to hang in there and finish on the podium for the first time this season. Didn't have a podium last year, didn't he? Indianapolis, was it?
Yes.
Told Espargaro as well.
He's missed out this year. He's been fourth on three occasions.
Here's the start again. Look at Mark.
I tell you who did well though. Dominika Goethe was about to clatter him. And he's pulled it to the right there, and Goethe's done extremely well to avoid Marquez. And look down there, he's down three from the back, four from the back there. So he was down in 29th position. Whoa! And he cluttered to the side of Goethe then, didn't he? Oh my goodness.
Your heart in your mouth. I mean,
there were some fierce moves coming through, but he clearly has the pace to get through on people.
Just watch this, the turn right.
Well, he'd have been heart in his mouth there as well.
How many people did he take at turn one?
Oh no, he wasn't even involved in that club collision out with Torres. Look at him just blast past De Angelis and Iannone.
It's an amazing first cut the bend for Marc Marquez. He's going to have to use all that, I think, in this battle with just a single opponent. And that's going to be Pol Espargaro with 6.5 laps to go. He hasn't broken him. How much has he used the tyres to have the ride like he did in those opening few laps?
I tell you what, Rabat is coming back now to Redding and Elias. Redding's pace has dropped back down into the 151s. And the gap which stood before at, well, it was about 3.5 seconds, is now at 2.4.
I've got to say, Tito Rabat is this week's Andrea Iannone. It looks like he's burned up his tyres, putting the pressure on Marc Marquez to allow Pol Espargaro to jump the gap. And now it looks like he's going to be swallowed up by Scott Redding, Tom Lutie, and back up for what is fourth place.
Pay the price. It was good while it lasted, wasn't it?
He's done it for the team. He's taken one for the team.
Six laps to go. Into the tunnel they would come. Elias had double left. And then into victory corner. It's in a quiet period now.
Yeah, but it's going to ramp up again here because Espargaro, just bit by bit, is closing in on Marquez. That last lap, a tenth. But a tenth on each of these last six laps will put him in the lead. Gap from the back to Redding, under 2 seconds now. So they pulled half a second on Tito Rabat on that lap.
It's Nakagami chasing Simone Corsi. It's the battle for seventh place.
Elias and Lutz will do well to stick in behind Redding here, and then they have a chance at the podium because Redding is closing that gap to Rabat.
Yeah, I think they're both experienced enough to know, just let Scott Redding pull them along till they get on the back of Tito Rabat.
And then start
attacking.
It's a good ride that from Ant West, have to say, starting 20th on the grid up into 12th place. Again, showing what he's capable of. In fact, he's the top speed up out there because Andrea Iannone down in 17th place.
Pol Espargaro really has got Marc Marquez in his sights now. knows he's there. It's going to be a cracking last 5 laps. When will the Espargaró make a move? Will he wait? Will he make a move soon?
There's nothing to choose between them now. Big look behind from Marc Márquez. They go down the back straight. See, there's gaps much too big for Espargaró to have a launch there. Just trying every corner to take another couple of inches out of Marquez's lead. Redding behind is closing fast now on Rabat, already half a second on this lap. You see there, Marquez, was, when he twisted the throttle, was almost here to say, come on, I need a little bit more from you.
Turn one, 5 laps to go, round 14 of the championship. The two championship leaders fight it out at the front.
Lines from both going into turn five. Has to win the race really to have any chance, because then if he went to Malaysia and it stayed like this, Marquez, if he won, would be champion, full stop.
Yeah, he could delay the game by winning the race. Espargaró, as we say, taking his fourth win of the season. He did win that previous round in Aragon. Marquez, former winner here. 25 cc class, second in the Moto2 race last year, won by Andrea Iannone.
Looks like Rabat has just responded to that pressure. Maybe had a pit board, just a hurry up sign and saving something for this last 4.5 laps. Gap stayed very steady on this one. About 1.6 now, so it's gone back out from 1.4.
It's a problem for Pol Espargaró now, he's closed up on Marquez, but he's still got to find a way past, and he's got to find a way past on the brakes. And the Suter is better on the front end, brake hard braking around this circuit than the Calyx is. So it's not going to be so easy once he closes right onto the back of the
mountain. He's having just a little problem closing right up as well, isn't he? He's not quite close enough yet with 4 laps to go.
Marquez has just set a personal best lap on that one, and that's why he's just keeping the pace very high. Redding runs very wide again in one. I mean, that might maybe his line. It's been a problem for him early on when he was under pressure from the likes of Marquez, Espargaró and Rabat.
So that Ricciardo trying to close up on Simone Corsi in their race for 7th place. Here he is, Andrea Iannone.
Down in 18th. What's gone on this weekend? That's the problem here. It could just happen, can't it? That race is Spain. Down in 14th. Germany qualified 10th, finished 16th. And then here, qualified down in 17th place. 18th place on the grid, and he's in 18th in the race as Espargaró gets even closer. He'd much prefer, as Ian said, through that twistier section or the more flowing section rather than the tighter braking areas like here into the group.
He's certainly the closest he's been. But this is the part that catches them out, and certainly by the time they get to the start and finish, it always seems that Marquez, once again, as Ian was saying, with the different frames, seems to have that advantage as he comes through the hairpin.
I think Rabat has responded enough now. Back out to 1.8, the gap to Redding. And it was him dropping his lap time on that previous one, down into the 151s, whereas Redding, Elias, Luthi all in the 152s. Luthi's passed Elias, and I think we've lost Tony Elias. There he is. Well, we were worried about him lasting the pace to the end. Being there in 4th place for much of the race. And that's an early bath for him. Just trying to hang on to Redding. And it's not to be, unfortunately. He made a great comeback. But the 2010 world champion has crashed out.
Elias out of the race at the front. Next part, if Espargaró is going to get the nibble, this is where he's going to get it, I think. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the S's.
Yeah, I think maybe it's the S curve.
Yeah, I don't think so well.
So it's a risky base to go. It's not very commonly go, but it could be the sort of surprise move he needs. Could have just lost the race there almost. Brought the back round brilliantly, but he tried to go in on the brakes. Marquez just was in his line and he was forced to pick the bike up. He's done well. Look at this, comes straight back. We really are fighting on the edge here now.
This is where he's closest to him. And then they go down again under the brakes for the V curve. Towards the hairpin. We ride with Marquez. We switch from a Pol Espargaró. Right, it leads away. And I don't think that this is where he hasn't really got the chance to get past it. Certainly racing down the hill towards the 90 degree corner is not going to be easy.
A really good battle for eighth going on. Ponce is currently in eighth. Very good day for their Ponce team. Well, Ponce in eighth. Zarco is now up into ninth again. Goethe 10th, West 11th, and Simon in 12th, and Torres is there in 13th. But they're all really within touching distance of each other.
Into the victory curve, there'll be two laps to go. And it's not here Pol Espargaró can get close enough to Marquez. I think you're right, two and five. He got so hot, he couldn't have a go at the S. But he's a lot closer this time round. He comes down towards turn three. We ride with Espargaró.
Big leg comes out from Marquez, wider line. Espargaró went a bit more on the inside.
From here to the V corner, I reckon this is a big chance, don't you? This is very strong.
Down towards five now. That's it now for Pol Espargaró. Could have almost taken out the rear of Marc Marquez, but it's not to be. And I think that could be even too much of a bridge for Espargaró to make up.
Yeah, it almost exactly happened on the previous lap, wasn't it?
I wouldn't be so sure.
No?
No, I don't think it's over yet.
Well, I hope you're right.
I don't think he's going to be able to win this one. We'll see what happens. Over the last lap and a half. There's Espargaró walks away from pit.
Let's hope we're wrong.
Marquez will still think he's there. And he'll still be riding. Maybe just a slight twitch from him. It's the battle for fourth place between Redding and Lüthi. It's been like this now for about the last 15, 16 laps.
Yeah. This is a three and now it's a two. There's Tito Rabat. It'll be a very, very well-earned podium for him. He just looks up the inside of Scott Redding, but there's no way through. The leaders will now go through the victory curve. They will be commencing their last lap.
Down into turn one, Marc Marquez on the last lap of the Japanese Grand Prix. Marquez has just set the new fastest lap of the race as well.
Going into the Malaysian Grand Prix in a week's time. There will be three more races left after
but
this.
But it would mean that Marquez was winning the race in Sepang. If he could do that, he'd be world champion.
Yeah, this is where Espargaró had a mighty good go the last couple of laps. This time he's not close enough, I don't think. I've got to say, it's an absolute masterclass by Marc Marquez after the start he made.
Absolutely brilliant. He's got to do something through here now. Espargaró looking, trying to take up the inches, and he is all the time. This is brilliant stuff from Espargaró. Through that flowing section, he has just made up masses and masses of room on the track. He's given himself a chance as they go down towards the hairpin, and that look behind from Marc Marquez, he'll know that Espargaró is still there. Here comes Espargaró, trying to take more metres out of Marquez's lead. Got to be down at the bottom of this straight now.
This race will be decided in the next 5 or 6 seconds. Marquez, big and strong. There's surely no way now through for Pol Espargaró.
You have to come just something up in these final couple of corners or into the final corner of the circuit. And Marquez is trying to just block the line. He thought about that one. He thought about it, Marquez. Just made sure there was no way through for Espargaró. Blocked him off. And Alexander Spargo in second. Mar Marquez wins once more and has the title within his grasp.
What a ride by Tito Rabat in the third place. His first podium finish of the season. Scott Redding 4, Tom Lucas 5. And Tito Pons looks on. Perhaps he's not going to win the world title this time, but he must be proud of his team. Simone Corsi in sixth place, Nakagami in seventh. That is relief as much as anything else after the start.
Zarco comes home there in eighth place, Pons 9th, Goethe 10th, Simon 11th, West dropped to 12th in that last lap, Torres in 13th, and Andrea is not even going to score a point.
Mike Domenico leads the point scoring in 15th place. That was some ride by Marc Marquez. Neutral at the start. Dreadful, dreadful start. Very, very lucky not to be collected by anybody racing in behind him. Rode through the field unbelievably in those first few laps. Took the lead, and despite the combined efforts of Tito Rabat and then Pol Espargaró, went on to win the race. Seventh win of the season. Surely now, one firm hand on that Moto2 World Championship. Great ride by Pol Espargaró. He gave it absolutely everything. Sorry, seventh win of the season for Marc Marquez. It gave it absolutely everything. A great day for the Pons team. Spargo second, Tito Rabat third, and Axel Pons in ninth place. Marquez 283, Pol Espargaró 230. That is a gap of 53 points. That remained the same. We left Sepang in Malaysia in 1 week's time. Marc Marquez will clinch his second world title before moving up to the MotoGP World Championship next season. Quite the race we saw in Aragon, a very different sort of race, but absolutely superb stuff. What a Tito Rabat, he did a great job for the team. All he could to slow up Mark Marquez, just to make life difficult for him. I don't think anybody was going to beat him today. Spanish teenager. Winner here a couple of years ago in the 125 season class. There we go. In neutral. By the time he gets into gear, 95% of the field have gone past him. Watch. You see some on-board stuff and he's really bent. He just carves like a knife through butter. Yeah, you're absolutely right. There's nothing more you could have done, Pol Espargaró. Great effort. Marquez is in this type of form. Controversial in some ways. He's had his controversy this weekend with the crash with Mika Kallio in free practice 3 on Saturday morning. He's given his team an absolute heart attack. I bet they say, what happened at the start?
I think we've seen two of Marc Marquez's greatest strengths this afternoon. This ability to get on with the job, not panic when things don't go his own way. The aggressiveness off the line, you know, making up places from the first corner. And then, you know, then knocking it into gear, finding his rhythm, and just getting it out there and putting in the pace he needed to put into all the points. Impressive stuff from Marquez tonight.
Yeah, one of his great rides, I think. We've seen some unbelievable rides by Spanish teenager on his way to winning that 125cc world title, almost the Moto2 title last season, but that was very, very special. Nakagami, rightly so, getting a warm round of applause from the crowd. He's finished in seventh place. It's a hug from his dad, Marc Marquez.
going to break in and grab a quick word with today's fourth place finisher, Scott Redding. Scott, another fourth place here in Motegi, but not an easy race, was it?
No, it was pretty tough, especially on the wrist, you know. I was definitely halfway through that race, I could feel it quite hard. It was a tough race as well with the straight and stuff. And I led the way, but I was making a couple of mistakes. Like, I just couldn't get the bike stopped. I don't know if there was a bit more wind or what, you know. And I was also struggling the last second to get my foot under the back shift. Three times I went into first and third. And, you know, I just had to, like, lose a bit of time going in to get it right. So hopefully next time we can go one more.
A big battle with Tony Elias, sort of first third of the race, and then a big battle with Tom Lutie at the end.
Yeah, I don't know if you call that a battle with Elias just coming by and completely running you off track, no intention to even make the corner. But yeah, I wasn't going to let him beat me anyway.
Okay, cheers, Scott. Congratulations.
Yeah, good drive by Scott Redding into fourth place. So good for Bradley Smith, mechanical problem sidelining him, and Gino Rea finishing in 25th spot. Well, it's been two really interesting races, Moto 3. I think the discussions about that race will go on long into the night and all the way. The aeroplane tomorrow for most people as we fly from Tokyo to Kuala Lumpur. And this Moto 2 race, I think the perfect example, which we already knew, didn't we? Marc Márquez is something very, very special indeed. It's going to be mighty interesting when he arrives in MotoGP next season. So, three Spaniards fill that podium. There's three Spaniards, wasn't it, on the front row of the grid. That's the first time that has ever happened in Moto2. Just a little reversal, an important reversal that Marc Márquez had actually won it. But it's Pol Espargaró who started from pole position. There you go, confirmation. 53 points between Espargaró and Márquez. Title battle between Andrea Iannone and Tom Lutie now for third place. They are separated by just 1 point. Scott Redding now looking much more comfortable in fifth place. Mika Kallio, Bradley Smith, and then Tito Rabat after his good ride today. Nakagami moves up a place after delighting the crowd here by finishing in seventh spot. Claudio Corti will start dropping down now. He's been placed in the team by Tony Elias, who crashed out of the race today. Axel Potten's gone up a couple of places. It's easily his best result of the season. Ninth place for Axel Potten. See, decent crowd here, these vast grandstands at Motegi. Really built to have a look at the Indy Oval. So parts of it will be empty because you can't actually see parts of the road racing track you want to see. Marc Márquez wins his seventh Grand Prix of the season. That was a very special victory indeed. Ian summed it up perfectly. We saw he is the complete motorcycle racer. He can scrap it when he has to. Boy, did he scrap it in those opening two or three laps. He can keep calm. The pressure's really on, as he did at the start. And then when he's got a lead, he's an almost impossible man to beat, as Pol Espargaró and Tito Rabat found.
I don't know, because what happened to you?
Gamsan, of course.
I don't know.
In charge of HRC's MotoGP effort. Congratulations to Marc Márquez. Looks like he's going to arrive in the team with Dani Pedrosa as the world champion. There's Scott Redding. Too complimentary, was he, about Tony Elias? Yeah, fourth place. What a good season, Scott Redding. Currently running in fifth place in the championship now, and looks like a good fifth place as well. Really cemented that fifth place today. The real battle is for third place between Andrea Iannone, who had a disaster to play today, and Tom Lutie. Iannone finishing out of the points in 18th, and Tom Lutie finishing fifth. Riders make their way to the podium. Tito Rabat really deserves that podium finish today. good weekend. His first ever front row start in Moto2. He did a great job for his teammate. But he was an irresistible force, wasn't he, Mark Marquez? The face of Emilio Alzamora is mental when he realised that his rider was in control at the start. I think fear as much as anything else, and he would get hit from behind, and did. So Tito Rabat from the third step of the podium, but he's as tall as a Mark Marquez on the top step, as you can see. Seventh Grand Prix victory of the season, another great ride by Paul Espargaro. It's Tito Rabat for the first time on the podium this season. Very deserving. Nice guy you can wish to meet off the track. Paul Espargaro, that's six podium finishes in the last six races. Really can't do any more than that. Trying to win the world title. The trouble is, you're up against the man alongside him and on that top step, Marc Márquez. Another extraordinary performance by the Spanish youngster. Surely now en route to that world title. Congratulations to Marc Márquez. Another Grand Prix win. A 53-point advantage in the World Championship. Three rounds remaining. In a week's time, we're at Sepang in Malaysia. Takes the title there. A week later at Phillip Island in Australia. And then we finish the season. Surely then he'll be the world champion and he'll be able to celebrate in front of his home fans. At Valencia in Spain. So sorry, I'm worried about those beautiful trophies made of paper and wood. I would think they've probably been taken away, haven't they? As the champagne flows. Tito Rabat enjoying his return to the podium. There you go, that's your first three in Moto2. Let battle recommence in 5 days' time for the first practice session at Sepang in Malaysia.